there you have it. That was the exact moment that Steelers fans realized that President Trump was at the game. He was in the stadium. Just listen to those roars, those chants of USA, USA. This is in the middle of deep blue Pittsburgh, so that must be very alarming for the Harris campaign. And NBC was even forced to cover Trump's appearance during their live telecast. You know this probably hurt them badly on the inside.
45th President of the United States, Donald Trump, in attendance tonight, invited guest of one of the suite holders here at Acrisure Stadium in Pittsburgh. Jets on top, 7-3.
So anticipation for Trump's appearance at the game has actually been building since yesterday. During Trump's rally yesterday, he announced that he would be attending the Steelers game, and he even brought out a Steelers superstar, Antonio Brown. He spoke during the rally, and then even after the rally, he's been on the campaign trail with Trump, and then here is a moment behind the scenes of them having a photo taken together. So apparently, Antonio Brown spent the day getting Steelers fans to register to vote. And in addition to that, he was actually passing out these towels. There are yellow towels that say Trump Vance, as well as red ones. Here is a moment of him passing out those towels to fans after he worked during the day to register new voters. You can hear their fans shouting his name, and the excitement actually grew so palpable that they just started chanting over and over, A-B, A-B, A-B. A-B! So not only did Antonio Brown endorse Trump, campaign with Trump, register new voters to vote, but he also signed up to be a poll watcher on Election Day to ensure that we have election integrity. And then you saw there he was autographing stuff for fans and passing out Trump Vance towels. Well, after all of that, he actually went to the airport to greet President Trump as Trump Force One arrived and to be the first person to welcome him to Pittsburgh.
Go, President. I'm here for the game with the President.
And the rest, as they say, is history. Like I said earlier, anticipation was building, so people were on the lookout. And people who were actually in the nosebleed seats were able to catch a glimpse of the motorcade as it came towards the stadium. Yep, and then just one more clip of the stadium roaring. This is really a similar clip. It's from the suite because President Trump was a guest of a box holder. So it is a very similar clip to the first one, but it is a different angle.
USA! USA!
Now, the reason this is such a big deal, several reasons why it's a big deal. Number one, again, deep blue Pittsburgh. I get football fans aren't representative of the entire city, but we've seen former presidents, President Bush, Obama, Bill Clinton, get booed at sporting events. Or at the very best, it's a mix. You have half boos, half cheers. Here, it's just a roar. Chants of USA, USA. No boos cutting through. And that wasn't even Trump being announced on the Jumbotron. That was just organic enthusiasm, word of mouth, people getting excited and showing their support. Truly a movement happening. But more importantly, Trump was at McDonald's earlier today, and I actually have brand new footage that I'm going to show you. But the reason this is important is because Kamala's closing message, it's not about you, it's not about me, it's not about the average American citizen and the working class family, it's not about people who are struggling to pay their bills and put food on the table. Kamala's closing message is about Trump's fitness. Kamala's closing message is that Trump is unstable, he's unhealthy, he's unwell. And so today, without even mentioning that, without even having to acknowledge this insane accusation from Kamala Harris, Trump proved all of that wrong by working at McDonald's, doing an entire campaign day filled with events, and then cherry on top, hey, I'm going to go to the Steelers game and get roars of approval. I mean, that's just something that doesn't happen. So here is a clip. Earlier, I made a video of Trump at McDonald's. Here's a clip that I didn't see until after I saw the video. And I just loved this moment. Just the interaction between Trump and the people. You can't stage this. This is real. This is authentic.
But I could do this all day. I wouldn't mind this job. I like this job. I think I might come back and do it again.
Thank you.
Look at that. Look at that. How are you?
Thank you, Mr. President. You made it possible for ordinary people like us to meet you.
You're not ordinary.
I mean, thank you so much for everything.
I can see.
We pray for you, and you are the type of person we want to be the president.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
So nice. Thank you very much. Yeah, I took a bullet. That's right.
Thank you, Mr. President.
When you think about it, I guess that's right.
Thank you very much.
I mean, did you hear how quick Trump's response was? He's the man in the car, the gentleman in the car saying, thank you for making it possible for ordinary people like us to meet you. And Trump says, you're not ordinary. I mean, to be that quick on your response, he doesn't need a script. He doesn't need lines to be tested, focus group tested. It's just an organic situation. Yes, of course it was staged in that they needed to shut down the McDonald's or like sweep it, you know, have the Secret Service come in, make sure everything was okay with Secret Service, right, for Trump's safety. But when we say it's organic, when we say that this is real, it's not like Kamala Harris where she's like, let me hit my mark, make sure the camera's rolling before I start doing anything. It's there's nothing pre-planned. Yes, there has to be preparation before Trump actually arrives to ensure his safety, but none of his interactions are pre-scripted for a viral moment, so to speak, because the entire thing is viral worthy. Another thing I didn't see earlier was apparently it was Kamala Harris's birthday today. And they asked him about it. They asked Trump about it when he was working the window. And I thought he was just very gracious, even though this is a hard-fought campaign. And again, I think this speaks to his character.
So, yes, ma'am.
Today's Kamala's birthday.
It's Kamala's birthday?
She's turning 60
years old.
Do you want to say anything?
Yes, I would say happy birthday, Kamala. She's turning 60.
Did you get her some fries?
I think I'll get her some flowers.
Why not to beat her
Maybe
again?
I'll get her some fries. You're right. That might be. I'll give her some McDonald's. I'll get her a McDonald's hamburger.
Thank you.
No, it is her birthday. It is true, right?
Yes.
Happy birthday, Kamala. Happy birthday. See you later. Bye. Thank you, everybody.
Mr. Trump, thank you very much.
Not only that, but he also posted it on Truth Social. Kamala, happy 60th birthday. What really caught my attention about that is it proves, I think, you know, I didn't use this exact word earlier because I think I was just so caught off guard by the spirit of the thing. But Trump seemed to be genuinely having fun. Really, like having fun. How often do you use the word fun with politics? I was reading the comments too in my last video. So many of you said you were smiling watching all of the clips. So many of you said it even, you know, made you emotional seeing Trump interacting with people like that. And I think the reason people are having such a strong response to this is because you can tell he really is having fun. And I think that's indicative of two things. Number one, it's indicative of perhaps Trump's confidence in the race or how he's feeling about the race. He doesn't feel the pressure to try to sell people on his candidacy or to try to sell people to vote for him. So he can go out there, actually have fun, because not only maybe is he confident in his standing in the race, but he's confident in his message. His message for everyday working class Americans. And so he really thinks he has this in the bag. Number two, the fact that the liberal media and Democrats are freaking out about this, I think the reason they're really losing their minds. I'm going to show you this clip from MSNBC here in a moment, and we're going to respond in real time, you and I together. But I think the reason the Democrats are freaking out is because he is having fun. The joy has left Kamala's campaign, and the joy is actually with Trump. And that's the difference with this McDonald's interaction. You just feel the joy authentically. When that couple in the car went up to the drive-thru and they're talking to Trump, I mean, did you not feel that? You didn't need to be told joy. You didn't need to be told happy, hope, change. It was an organic feeling that you felt. It wasn't manufactured. It wasn't a campaign slogan. It was actually real. And I think that's why Democrats and the media are freaking out right now. And MSNBC ran this whole segment. And I'm going to respond in real time. I started watching the first 15 seconds and I was like, you know what? This is ridiculous. I just want to watch it and just respond as these thoughts come to me. So let's go on this ride together.
I mean, if you're on his campaign, and I know you are certainly not, I'm not making any implication of that, but what is the logic behind this, going to a McDonald's? I mean, we know the guy likes Big Macs and Filet-O-Fish, and he's used the word love to describe the way he feels about the food there before. But what's this about?
Okay, obviously, Trump is trying to relate to working class voters. Not only has he announced proposals, policy proposals like no tax on tips, no tax on overtime, so he's making an appeal to working class voters, but he is now also really honing in by actually working a job of the working class. He's also bringing dignity to those jobs, if you think about it, because he's saying there is no job too small, too little. If you think about it, we are, as a society, all reliant on each other. No job is more important than another. The person who, I don't know, comes to take your trash is just as important as whoever designs your automobile is just as important as the doctor. Like, I get that, you know, for whatever reason, we prescribe and assign value and worth to certain jobs. And I get it. You know, people who are doctors obviously have to study hard, have to work hard. And, you know, you hope they're smart. You hope they're ethical. They should be. They should be. And so you hold them to a higher standard. But that doesn't mean that they're better or more important people than, you know, people working fast food jobs. We all have to work together to make society run. I don't know if that makes sense. I hope I'm trying to prove my point. So I think that's the point that Trump is making here with this campaign spot. But it's also a statement about his health, because Kamala's closing message in the campaign is Trump is too weak, he's unstable, he's unwell. Well, think about this. Trump worked the French fries. If the Trump campaign was really hiding a health crisis, if he was unwell, unable to stand, maybe he's going to fall over anytime, maybe he can't lift things like they're suggesting, do you really think the campaign, the Secret Service, would have risked him standing next to an open thing of boiling hot oil that could have, like, disfigured him for life if something were to happen and, like, he fell in? Put his hand in, fainted. Like, the Trump campaign, it visually took away that line of attack for Kamala Harris.
There's no logic to it. It's a stunt. He has not put forth an economic agenda. He, as you know, appears to be not well. And he's engaged in some really bizarre types of activities during this campaign. So this is just another one of those stunts that he will continue on through the campaign. And I think that we need to really focus on making sure that he is not elected, of course, because he is a threat to our democracy, but also the Harris loss agenda is about the economy, reducing the cost of living, reducing the cost of prescription drugs, reducing the cost of housing, and making life better for everyone. And that's what we have to focus on and make sure we get every voter to the polls and make sure that the voters vote for the future, not taking the country backwards, as you see what Donald Trump continues to try to do.
Not taking it backwards. It's the left who is trying to divide us. I mean, white dudes for Harris. The left is literally segregating us. They're trying to, look, I get it's not real segregation, but you get what I'm saying. It's a slippery slope. The moment you start dividing people, white dudes for Harris, straight dudes for Harris, whatever it may be, and I've seen that too, it's divisive. We shouldn't be voting on someone based on our own immutable characteristics. We should be voting because of their policy and because of their character. I mean, they're the ones being divisive here. Now, I will say there is a counterpoint to that. A lot of people will say, well, Daniel, why do Republicans and why does the Trump campaign talk about black people voting for Trump? Well, the reason has nothing to do with race. We're not saying, oh, you're a black male, you should vote for Trump. No, the reason that race gets brought up is because minorities have historically voted for Democrats. So whenever race gets brought up on the Republican side, it is only about, hey, look, these norms are breaking. And Democrats are losing their stranglehold on certain demographics. Something is happening on the ground. So when there is a difference when it comes to just even the discussion on race when it comes to the two parties.
So I'm urging and encouraging everyone to get to the polls and vote for Kamala Harris and Tim Walz to be their next president and vice president.
Last but not least, in that clip, did you hear her talking openly? I thought they were supposed to be the news. Like, I've made it clear on my channel that I am striving to be a commentator and a news analyst. So I, with the exception of two videos ago, I've never said, hey, you need to go out there and vote for Trump. Yes, I would love it if you did. But that hasn't been the goal of my content. The goal of my content is just to provide the news, and then I make it very clear. Like, I don't distort the news. I provide you the facts, and then I provide you my analysis and my commentary. But that right there, on that MSNBC clip, you heard her spend half of it talking about, oh, we can't reelect him. We can't. And there's supposed to be a news channel. There is a line between journalism and then analysis, commentary, and then activism. And it feels like MSNBC really has taken away that middle part where I am. They've taken away the analysis and the commentary, and they're trying to blend news with activism. And that's why people don't trust the media. That clip was just absolutely ridiculous. Last but not least, I wanted to end with this clip of JD Vance. By the way, his rallies have been growing. He had a slow rollout. A lot of people weren't really impressed during the RNC with his debut. But man, once he found his footing, he started walking, he started jogging, he started running, now he's sprinting, and people are catching on. His rallies are just growing larger. Well, a few nights ago, someone yelled, Jesus is King, Christ is Lord, at Kamala Harris's rally, and she said, oh, I think you're at the wrong rally. Well, someone shouted that at JD Vance at his rally, and he had a totally different response.
Anti-Christian rhetoric and anti-Christian approach to public policy. That's right, Jesus is King, and I don't think that we've seen... I don't think that we've seen anything like this in modern American politics.
A moment like that, you just can't script. I mean, this campaign has been one for the history books, one for the ages. I mean, just take a look at this photo. If you think about everything that we've gone through, from the indictments, the mugshot, Trump going into bodegas, gas stations, the assassination attempt, the Kennedy endorsement, Tulsi Gabbard, Elon Musk, now McDonald's. I mean, have we ever seen anything like this? Just absolutely insane. Now, going back to the original topic of the video, I know we crammed a lot in there. Trump at the Steelers game. There was a roar of approval. Do you think that that's promising? Do you think that that's maybe an indicator that Pittsburgh isn't going to be as deep blue as it usually is? Yes, of course, we know it's going to go blue, but maybe it's going to be a navy blue, rather than like the depths of the ocean blue. Maybe it'll even be a baby blue instead of a navy blue. I don't know. Or do you think that doesn't really say much? Football fans are different from the regular demographic. Football fans tend to be more concerned. I don't know if I necessarily buy that. I think you can be a sports fan regardless of your political ideation. I don't know. Just my point of view. But let me know your thoughts in the comments below. I'd be interested to hear about that because I haven't done any research into that. I don't know if, you know, maybe conservatives flock more to football than progressives. Could be. I wouldn't be surprised just off the top of my head. A few issues come up, but I haven't, you know, done any scholarly research to see if there's any data on that. So I'd be interested to hear your thoughts. If you haven't already, please be sure to give me a thumbs up. I know it's a simple thing to ask, but it really does help me to reach more viewers like you in the algorithm. I will be introducing my dog. I've been seeing a lot more comments about this, by the way. A lot more. And I know people subscribe at different times. I know people don't watch the whole video. And I know it's a shame that I save it for the end. So maybe one of these days I'll put it at the beginning. But I purposely have not introduced my pets. That will be the celebration, introducing my dog and my cat, if and when I'm lucky to cross 100,000 subscribers. So be sure to smash that subscribe button, not for me, but for them, and to check out one of these videos.